गुड इवनिंग स्टूडेंट्स, आई एम डॉक्टर कमला, असिस्टेंट प्रोफेसर ऑफ पॉलिटिकल साइंस, न्यू गवर्नमेंट डिग्री कॉलेज, सेरलिंगमपल्ली, रंगारेड्डी डिस्ट्रिक्ट, तेलंगाना. टुडे वी आर गोइंग टू डिस्कस अबाउट द इंडियन फेडरल सिस्टम. ओके, सो बिफोर दैट we will discuss about its history, right? So the Indian federalism actually dates back to Lord Mayo's decentralization policy of 1870. Okay, Lord Mayo's decentralization policy of 1870. Now even the Government of India Act 1919 has provided for the federal character to India. Now the Montfort reforms actually provided for a federal frame for India in a limited measure by way of division of powers between the center and the provinces. So provinces means what? Yes, small units or states, we can say. So India has how many states today? No, anyone? Yes, 29 states. And how many union territories we have? 9 union territories. Okay, so India has 29 states and 9 union territories. Now how the powers have been, see, in federal system what is the main objectives is to understand the unity in diversity. Okay, and how the devolution in authority and decentralization in administration takes place. Now what is centralization and decentralization? Yes, in centralization the total authority will be in the hands of the center and there will be no division of power, and in decentralization there is a division of power, okay, between the units, right? Now it also has the objective to attain common welfare, okay, in order to have a wide diversity in social, cultural and economic spheres, right? So Article 1 of the Indian Constitution states that India, that is Bharat, shall be union of states. Okay, it is a union of states. As I have told that today, as of now, we have 29 states and 9 union territories. Now there should be a cordial relations between the union as well as the states, then only the nation can be developed. Okay, so there should be a cooperation and coordination as well among the union government as well as the state government, because see, we have a union of states. What Article 1 of the Indian Constitution states that India is a union of states. Now before we proceed, first we look at the term, the federation, which is derived from Latin word fides. Fides means an agreement. Okay, now Indian, as far as our Indian political system is concerned, it is not an agreement, you have to remember. And not only that, the term federation is not mentioned anywhere in our constitution. That you need to remember, students, the term federation is nowhere mentioned in our constitution. Okay, so, and not only that, it is not an agreement. Okay, actually the term federation is nothing but it is an agreement. Agreement is made between the two parties. Here we are not based our federation on agreement. Okay, Now, actually, the Indian Federation is based on two conditions. One is India, as we have discussed, that Article 1 of the Indian Constitution states that India is a union of states, right? And at the same time, no state, see, we have said that there are 29 states. Now, no state has the authority to separate from the union government or to secede from the Indian states, right? Or Indian nation, we can say. So, one is India is a union of states, and the other one is no one has the authority to separate, okay, from the union. That you need to remember. So, the term federation is derived from Latin word fides, which means agreement. And the Indian Federation is actually based on two conditions. One is India is a union of states, and the other one is no state. That is, Indian state cannot secede from the union. Now, see, federalism is a system of government in which power is divided between a central authority and constituent political units. Okay, now what is it? In the central government, we have union government. Yes, right. And in the states, we have different constituent political units. So, there is a division of powers, right? So that the decentralization process will be taken on effectively or to in order to achieve the central or the national goals. Okay, national goals. So, Indian federalism, if we see, is different from the type of federalism that is practiced in countries like the United States of America. See, we have actually partially some of the features are we have federal features and as well as unitary features. So, we have the combination of both the unitary as well as federal features. That is why Professor Casey Ware has rightly stated that Indian federalism is not completely a federal government or not a completely unitary government. So, he has coined the term quasi-federal. Quasi-federal. Okay? So, we there are kinds of federations. Okay? Now, we'll discuss about the two kinds of federation. Now, one is holding together federation. Now, in this type, if we see, powers are shared between various constituent parts in order to accommodate the diversity in the whole entity. Okay, here the powers are generally titled towards the central authority. Okay, all the major powers are generally titled towards the central authority. Example, if we take India, Spain and Belgium. Okay, so holding together federation. So, unity is strength, we can say. That is the reason. See, India is a multi-religious multi-religious country. Yes, and it is a multilingual country, right? So, and it has a different, cultures, multicultural country. So, we need to have unity in order to. So, holding together is very much important in a federation. That is why the powers are generally titled towards the central authority in order to achieve a common welfare of the nation. Right. Next, other kind of federation is coming together federation. Now, in this type, generally, the independent states will be there. Now, those independent states will come together in order to form a larger unit. Okay, small units will come together in order to what? to form a larger unit. Here, the states generally enjoy more autonomy as compared to holding together. So, when it is compared to holding together, here the states where coming together federation will enjoy more autonomy, right? So, here we can give the example of USA, Australia, Switzerland. Okay, here they enjoy more autonomy than the federation that is holding together. Now, let us discuss about the other types of federalism we have. Here, actually, you have nothing to do with asymmetric federalism, cooperative federalism, competitive federalism, creative federalism. But you need to know what are the other types of federalism that are prevailing in the world. So, we generally need to discuss here. I will briefly discuss about this, and you have to be very thorough, because see, only the term federalism we know, but not only that, we should know what are the other types of federalism that are existing in the world. So, dual federalism is nothing but there will be two forms of government, that is one at the center and another one is at the state level. Okay, so that will have two types of governments. One is central government and the other one is the state government. That we will discuss. Okay, next, asymmetric federalism. Now, what is actually asymmetric federalism? It is generally a federation in which different constituent states possess different powers. Okay, different constituent states. For example, there are five states. The five states possesses different powers. Okay, one or more of the substances has considerably more autonomy than other substates. Okay, so one or more of the substates has considerably more autonomy than other substates. Now, although actually they have same constitutional status, so they have the same constitutional status. Do you remember what is asymmetric federalism? Because you need to know when we are reading, when we are knowing about types of means federalism, we should know what is asymmetric federalism. So, it is generally a it is a federation in which different constituent states possess different powers. Okay, one or more of the substates has considerably more autonomy than other substates. So, all these substates, they have same constitutional status. Okay, next, we will discuss about cooperative federalism. Now, cooperative federalism, in other words, is also known as marble cake federalism. Cooperative federalism is also known as marble cake federalism. Okay, so in this type of cooperative federalism, generally the state as well as where the local governments are there, both state and local governments interact cooperatively and collectively to solve all the common problems, which are having the common problem that will be solved with both state as well as local governments, which through they directly means they interact cooperatively and collectively. See, this is very much important in order to solve all the problems that are existing in our state or the local government. So, cooperative federalism is also known as what? Marble cake federalism. Okay. So, see, in intermediate we don't discuss, but in degree you need to know what types of federalism are there. So, you just remember this. Okay. सो एसिमेट्रिक फेडरलिज्म, कोऑपरेटिव फेडरलिज्म, कोऑपरेटिव फेडरलिज्म इन अदर वर्ड्स इज ऑल्सो नोन एज मार्बल केक फेडरलिज्म, वेयर द स्टेट एंड द लोकल गवर्नमेंट्स इंटरैक्ट कोऑपरेटिवली एंड कलेक्टिवली इन ऑर्डर टू सॉल्व द कॉमन प्रॉब्लम्स. नाउ वी विल डिस्कस अबाउट कॉम्पिटिटिव फेडरलिज्म. Now, what is competitive federalism? Actually, it is competitive federalism is a subfield of public economics. Public economics is a subfield of public economics. Okay. Now, actually, fiscal federalism, it is also known as fiscal federalism, which is concerned with understanding, okay, which functions and instruments are best centralized and which are best placed in the sphere of decentralized levels of government. Okay, so what does it mean? It is generally understand what are the functions and instruments that are best centralized and which are to be placed in the sphere of decentralized levels of government. Okay, next, what is that? Creative federalism. Now, what is creative federalism? It is also known as picket fence federalism. Picket, P-I-C-K-E-T, picket, F-E-N-C-E, fence, picket fence federalism. Creative federalism is also known as picket fence federalism. So, in this picket fence federalism allows federal government to decide what the state need and then provide them with the resources. Okay, actually what the state needs, because it needs some resources. So, when it needs some resources, this type of creative federalism provides what the resources. Okay, so once again, what is this? Yes, you just read it. Dual federalism, asymmetric federalism, cooperative federalism, competitive federalism, creative federalism. So these are the types of federalism, right? Now we look at the definition. Okay, so A.V. Dicey, according to him, federalism means the distribution of powers of the state among a number of coordinated bodies, each originating in and controlled by the constitution. Now, who are coordinated bodies? Yes, generally the states. For example, India has 29 states. So, what happens? There will be a distribution of powers, right? Now, for example, in India, we have three lists: union list, state list, concurrent list. So, there will be division of powers among the state among a number of coordinated bodies. So, each originating and controlled by. So, everyone has to be controlled within the sphere of their limits and which is controlled by the constitution. Okay. Now, features of federalism. We'll discuss now what are the features of federalism. So, first feature is what? Dual governments, right? Second one is division of powers. Third one is written constitution. And fourth one is independent judiciary. Now, these are most essential. If these features are there, then that is a perfect federation, we can say. Okay. But in India, in Indian framework, we have these federal features. Not only these federal features, but also we have unitary features, right? So that we will discuss as we proceed further. Okay, and what is this? a dual government. So we are going to discuss about dual government. See here, it is a national government. Now it is a state government. Okay, this federation is what balancing between what there should be a cooperation or coordination between the national government and state government. See, state governments are different state governments. Like for example, in India we have 29 states. So 29 state governments should coordinate with the national governments. Okay, the national government gives instructions to the state government, and the state governments have to follow the directions in order to achieve the common objective. Now, in dual governments, we have what? There will be two governments. Okay, in a federation, there will be two governments. One is the federal or the union or the national government. Okay, one is what? Federal or union or the national government, and the other one is what? The state or provincial governments. Provinces is nothing but, sorry, here India has 29 states. Okay, India has 29 states, here 9 union territories. Please note this. Okay, so we have in a federation, we have two governments. One is the federal or union or national government, and the other one is what? The state or provincial governments. Now, actually, the constitution provides, okay, or creates these governments. Okay, in India, actually, we have 29 states and 9 union territories. Okay, please make a note of it, students. Rightly, presently, we have 29 states and 9 union territories. Now, the government at the center, this is a typing mistake, okay, which is the Lok Sabha and the Rajya Sabha. Okay, so at the center, what we have? We have two houses. One is Lok Sabha, that is lower house, and the other one is Rajya Sabha, the upper house. Now, the various governments also. At the state level, we have the Vidhan Sabha, okay, and the Vidhan Parishad. Okay, Vidhan Sabha and Vidhan Parishad, Legislative Council and the legislative assemblies. Okay, legislative assembly and the legislative, Vidhan Sabha and Vidhan Parishad. Okay, Vidhan Sabha is legislative council, legislative assembly, and the Vidhan Parishad is legislative council. The upper house and the lower house of the states is called as Vidhan Sabha and Vidhan Parishad. As how the in the center we have Lok Sabha and the Rajya Sabha, so also we have two types of governments at the central level as well as the state level. Okay, that is dual government. And finally, at the lowest level, we have what? The municipal corporations also and the panchayat, which are the forms of generally the local governments. Okay, so here in a federation, actually we have two governments. One is federal or union or the national government, and the other one is the state or provincial government. And the constitution generally provides or creates these governments. Presently we have 29 states and 9 union territories. So at the central, we have two houses. One is Lok Sabha and the Rajya Sabha. And at the state level, we also have two governments or the two houses, that is Vidhan Sabha and the Vidhan Parishad, Legislative Assembly and the Legislative Council. And not only that, we also have union territories, okay, which are under the governance of the central government. Okay, these 9 union territories are under the governance of whom? Central government. Okay, is it clear? Yes, students. Shall I proceed? Okay. Now, division of powers. Let us look at the second feature. Now, division of powers. See here. The division of powers between the center and states. Now, there are actually 3 lists which are in the 7th schedule of the Indian Constitution. Okay. These lists are very much essential. You need to remember, students. So, powers have been divided between them. Now, what are major powers are vested in the central government, and the states which are locally essential or important have been vested with the state government. So, we have 3 lists in the 7th schedule. You need to remember how many schedules are there, right? And how, which schedule deals with what, you need to remember. Because in competitive examination, they might ask the question, how many lists are there, okay? And these lists are placed in which schedule, okay? How many schedules are there in the constitution? So, you need to remember this, students. So division, we have 3 lists in the 7th schedule of the Indian constitution, which gives the subjects each level as jurisdiction in 1. The union list, which contains presently 98 subjects which are of major national importance. Okay, which are major national importance. Okay, so what is your homework is, what are the subjects that comes under the union list, that you should note down and come with your assignments. Okay, don't come blindly to the classroom. Please learn something what we have discussed. So union list contains 98 subjects. Earlier it was only 97 subjects, but now presently we have 98 subjects which are of national importance. Okay, now I am giving the clue, which are of national importance. Now you have to list out at least a few. Okay, every student list out at least 10. Okay, so that you will cover all the subjects. Okay, now the second list is the state list, which actually covers the subjects of 59. It contains 59 subjects. Earlier 66 subjects were there in the state list, but this subject currently has been reduced to 59 subjects. Okay, next, the third list is concurrent list. Now concurrent list, actually earlier we had only 47 subjects, but now increased to 52 subjects. Okay, so we have 3 lists. These 3 lists are mentioned in the 7th schedule of the Indian constitution, and the 3 lists are the union list, which contains 98 subjects, and the state list, which contains 59 subjects, and the concurrent list, 52 subjects. So students, please do the homework. What are the subjects that comes under union list, and what are the subjects that comes under the state list, and what are the subjects that comes under the concurrent list? This is the homework for you. Now, we'll discuss about written constitution. So, the Indian constitution actually is the longest constitution in the world, because different provisions have been borrowed from the other constitutions of the world. Okay, so it has become the bulkiest constitution in the world, and so it has been compared with it has been you know been what given the structure of elephant structure by A.V. Kamath, because see it has originally it has contained 395 articles, but presently we have around 470 articles. So many amendments have been made, so that is why it has become most bulkiest constitution in the world, we can say. So it contained generally when the Constitution of India came into force on 26th January 1950, it originally contained only how many articles? 395. Now presently we have how many articles? Nearly 470 articles we have. Okay, so not only that, now presently we have 12 schedules. Earlier it were only 8 schedules, and earlier we have 24 parts, but now we have 25 parts. Okay, so you need to remember that presently we have, sorry, here it is 490, actually it is 470. Students, please note this one. It is four, not 490, it is 470 articles. So originally when it came into force in 1950, it contained only 395 articles, 8 schedules and 24 parts. But presently we have 12 schedules and 25 parts. Okay? Now, independent judiciary. Okay? So, independent judiciary generally, see, in an independent, what do you mean by actually independence of judiciary? Now, in the words of Dr. V.K. Rao, independence of judiciary has three meanings. This is meanings. Here is the typing mistake. Only meaning is there. It has three meanings. According to whom? Dr. V.K. Rao. So, the judiciary must be free from encroachment from other organs in its sphere. Now, what are the other organs? Legislature and executive. Okay. Now, government has three organs. One is legislature, the other one is executive, and the third one is judiciary. So, the judiciary must be free from encroachment from other organs in its sphere. According to whom? Dr. V.K. Rao. And the second one is the freedom of the judgments and free from legislative intervention. Now, when the judge is giving the judgments, he should feel free. Because, see, sometimes what happens, the legislative interferes in the judgment. So, that is why it should give such an autonomy so that it should have an independent in delivering the judgments. Okay. So, the third one is the decisions of the judiciary should not be influenced by either the executive or the legislature. Now, in the first point itself, what the judiciary should be must be free from encroachment from other organs in its sphere. So, what are the other organs? It is executive and legislature. So, the decisions of the judiciary, whatever the judgment is given by the judges, should not be influenced either by the executive or the issue the legislature. They should not compel or they should not force the executive while delivering the judgment. So independence of judiciary, according to Dr. V.K. Rao, is the judiciary must be free from the encroachment of other organs in its spheres, and the freedom of judgments and free from legislative interference, and the decisions of the judiciary should not be influenced by either the executive or the legislature. Now, here I forgot to discuss about the Supreme Court generally acts as the custodian of the Constitution. So, it protects, generally the Supreme Court protects the Constitution. What is actually Constitution? Yes? Oh my God, I have discussed, you know, already. Yes, it is a set of rules and regulations framed in a document. Is known as Constitution. Okay, so Constitution, what these laws and what are the rules and regulations are protected by the Supreme Court. Now, actually, the Supreme Court generally enjoys the power of judicial review. So, when the legislature, the other organ of the government, makes a law that is contradictory to the Constitution, then that law can be nullified or striked off. That is called as the power of judicial review. Judicial review is a concept that actually borrowed from the American Constitution, and the famous judgment of or the famous case of Madison versus Marbury. Generally we quote in 1803, this concept has been borrowed. Okay, so whenever the laws are made by the legislature that are against to the Constitution, that can be striked off by the judiciary. So it enjoys the power of judicial review. Okay, so what we have discussed, we have discussed about that actually Indian Federation is a combination of both unitary features as well as federal features. But in order to have what American style of federalism or Canadian style of federalism, we need to have these four important features. But we have the India's, as coming to India, we have the combination of both federal as well as unitary features. So we have the combination of both, so that is why it is called as quasi-federal state. Apart from this, we federal features, we have what for example, single citizenship have, that is a unitary feature. Okay, and All India Services, means the All India Services, this recruitment of the services will be done by only central government, right? And the emergency of the emergency powers of the presidents are also vested with the president. Now, what these are all the features of the unitary government, and the state governors are appointed by the president. So all these features comes under the unitary government. So we have the combination of both, federal as well as unitary features. That is why we are not completely federal or completely unitary. So that is why it is termed as quasi-federal by K.C. Weir. So we have discussed what today? We have discussed about what is federation, what types of federation we have, and the other kinds of federation, like dual federalism we have discussed, asymmetric federation we have discussed, cooperative or marble cake federation we have discussed, right? And competitive federation we have discussed, creative federation or picket fence federalism we have discussed. Then we have discussed about the definition of federalism, right? Then we have discussed about features of federalism. What are the features? Yes, right now we have discussed, one is dual government, the other one is what we have discussed. Yes, division of powers we have discussed. Then we have discussed what written constitution, right? We have discussed what the other the independent judiciary. So these are the important features, or the that features which make completely federal structure. We are discussing about. We also discussed about the centralizing features, like centralizing features, like for example, the central government has given more major subjects, right? Like defense, and railways, BSNL, banking services, all these comes under the union list. So what happens? The central government becomes more powerful than the state governments. Not only that, the emergency powers of the presidents also vest with the central, right? And the parliament is also empowered to legislate the state, right, sometimes, and to it is also empowered to alter the boundaries and names of the states, and the other like governors are appointed by the president, and the central government also has a right to give directions to the states, right? So we will discuss all these things in the next class. Okay, students, so please revise once again, and thank you. Thanks a lot.